And I'm a great believer that, and experienced many times in work I've done with people and with groups, in the quality of working with sound and crystals and our consciousness. And if you've never done anything like this before, just start, if you're comfortable with it, just start with a murmur or an om or just a sound that comes to you. But I've worked with some people here and I'm going to ask you to step up the mark and support me in this and come out and work with your sound in whichever way is appropriate for you. And just take a deep breath. And what we're going to be doing is just expressing the sounds that our being wishes to express in this time. And we'll just be making some notes, and there'll be probably a crescendo at some point, and then it'll naturally just settle down to a quiet sound. And we'll just make the sound that's appropriate for this space, in this group, in this time. And some of you I know like to, like me, like to use your arms to move the sound, so if you want to do that as well. And sometimes that your arms just sort of move up and down and around, and just feel free. Staying in this space, just feel the vibrancy of your energy bodies, oscillating and enjoying the sound currents. And become aware of parts of your energy field and your body becoming lighter, easier, or even waking up. And take your attention into your heart, into the center of your chest, and bring your attention into your back, between your shoulder blades. And give permission for your wings to open out. Unfurl your wings may notice that it might have changed colour. There may be new colours since you last unfurled them. Let your wings out. And if you feel comfortable with it, just give them a little flutter. And just feel that in a space like this, it's safe to unfurl your wings. And let them shine. Body, especially your shoulders, might need to adjust slightly as your wings flutter and enjoy the company of many other wings. And the interesting thing about our wings is that when we're in the company of other wings, they don't clash next to each other. They can coexist wide open without us having to compromise in any way. And staying in that consciousness with your wings unfurled, just open your eyes, and when you're ready, just take a seat.
To talk about my work with the Crystal Oversouls, I need to sort of go back a few years to my childhood, because I think when I talk about this, it's a very good way of seeing my story and other people's stories, and often a lot of people can relate to what I'm about to talk about. But I will get to the Crystal Oversoul at some point. When I was a child, I was very aware that I was very aware of energies around me. I was very aware of beings. I was very aware of spheres of light, and I was very aware that I was seeing spheres of light, or seeing beings. I didn't know that term when I was a child, but I was very aware that I was seeing beings and also hearing them at the same time. So I see energy and hear it simultaneously. So when I listen to music, for example, I see music at the same time. Don't see notes, I see sort of energy. And when I look at, say, art, for example, paintings, I hear the painting at the same time. So it has music associated with it as well. And the same goes for me with crystals as well. Crystals they are very beautiful forms, of course, but it's the energy and the sound that they emit which is of interest to me and what I'm drawn to. So I was born like this, and I was gifted with that as a child. And I had a very strong sense as a child not to talk about it. I was very aware that I was born into a family where there was no religious background at all, which was a blessing for me, and on some level, obviously a choice of mine, so that I didn't have any sort of religious dogma which would try and stamp that out. But still, I had a sense to keep quiet about it, and I had a very strong sense as a child that was everyone I was playing with, and my brothers and sisters didn't have that same experience. So I kept quiet about it. But it didn't necessarily change my relationship with the energy. I was still aware that the energies were just very curious to me. They would appear like spheres of light. And sometimes, even now, if I take sort of photograph, and spheres appear in photographs, or people sometimes call them sort of paranormal photographs. That, to me, is pretty much how they look like. They're often spheres that sort of dance around and move around. And when I was a child, they would often talk to me, but not in the sense that they would talk like we're talking now. It'd be more telepathic talking. But they didn't necessarily tell me details I'd use as a child. But there were two beings in particular that were very interesting to me, and they were would stand outside of my bed, and they were very tall beings, and they continued to be very tall beings. And they were what I look at as my sort of protective, they were like my light parents, if you like. And that's how I viewed them. And in the sense that they always imparted a feeling to me that that they were star parents. So they were sort of like guardians. And so these beings were the two that I spoke to most, or spoke to me, and they would sort of imbue me with information. And so I had this sort of quite odd childhood. And I kept very quiet about this, and that worked for me as well to protect that, because I didn't abandon that you know, vision or that contact at all. And at a very early age, I was very drawn. My pocket money I used to spend on Eric von Danken books, and those really tiny little books you see for a few pence in a charity shop. And my brothers and sisters were buying sort of Cindy magazine and so forth, and Beano and thing, and I was buying Eric von Danken books, and I was fascinated by spaceships, by who built the pyramids, who made the Nazca lines, all those usual things, and that information sort of spoke very deeply to me, and sort of made sense to me that there was more to this world than met the eye, and what I was being taught in school as well. And you know, I've got different opinions about Eric von Danken now, but anyway, as a child I was absolutely fascinated by stars, by star beings, by crystals and so forth. And the beings, the two beings in particular who sort of guided me, gave me a great sense that later in my life all of this would have a meaning, because as a child it didn't have very much of a meaning for me. It seemed to conflict with going to school and, you know, talking to other children and cousins and brothers and sisters. Their interests were very, very different to mine. So it didn't seem, as a child, it didn't seem that it had no importance as a child, if you like, but I had this great sense that later in my life it would all make sense. And probably in my teenage years was the time I sort of went off the rails, really, as one should do, really, as being a teenager, you know, the usual teenage things. And that was probably the time when I turned my back on it most, because a lot of people I was around were drinking, doing soft drugs, and, you know, all the usual, you know, hanging out, to climbing out the bedroom window and going out till 2 o'clock in the morning and drinking cheap cider and all those sort of things. So everyone I was around was obviously not into consciousness in any way. And for quite a few years at that time, I felt that I tried all these different things, thinking that would make me fit in. So, you know, I drank cheap cider at 2 o'clock in the morning. I wanted a sense of belonging, because I felt that in the people I was around, I didn't belong. I felt very much an outsider. And I can see now that a lot of the things I was involved in was just because I wanted to fit in and I wanted to connect with other people. And I thought that's the way you did it. You know, you start smoking, and well, I did smoking and drinking and all those things. And around about the age of 18, 19, a shift started to take place. And I started around about that time getting involved in politics, and green politics in particular. And that was when I started to feel a sense of belonging, because there was a lot of people I started to meet, especially in those early years of the sort of forming of the Green Party and Greenpeace and Friends of the Earth. They were on a very small scale at that point. And there was a lot of people drawn to that who were feeling a sense of, we're here to do something, we don't quite know what it is, but certainly in my generation, and maybe it's politics, maybe this is the way forward. And so I started getting involved in that, and getting very heavily involved in the Green Party, because I felt with what I'd experienced as a child that I felt like I was here on purpose, that it wasn't just, you know, an accident. I was here to do something. I was here to contribute something and to somehow make sense of what I'd experienced as a child, to make that into how can that come into the world? How can that be normal? And so anyway, got involved in green politics. And slowly, what I tended to experience in those years was I would get involved in something, and then slowly my being, my sort of inner guidance, would guide me away from something. You're going, okay, you know, you've tested that, you've tasted that, and now that's not quite it. But it was like, you know, this funny little journey I was on, that I would try different things, and then something else would grab my attention. And so around about that time, there were people I was around who were into meditation, and in particular circle dancing. And I don't know if many of you have come across circle dancing, but circle dancing is an extremely powerful, beautiful sense of belonging and dancing together. And normally dancers from around the world it's very, you don't hear much of it anymore, but in those days when I was that age, that there was quite a lot of circle dancing groups around. And so that, something in that, in circle dancing and meditation, I started to have a sense that I'm landing somewhere. That's what it felt like at that time. This is what I've been looking for. And around about the time somebody gave me my first crystal, which I've still got. And at that point, the circle dancing festivals, there were often crystal tables on the side, and selling a few books, and it was a very different scene to these days, in terms of there weren't any shops around, and there might have been, of course, there was one in Glastonbury, but outside of the bubble of Glastonbury, there weren't any other crystal shops or books, anything like that, on the market. So it was only at these little circle dancing gatherings or New Age festivals you'd come across them. And so anyway, a friend of mine gave me a crystal, and that was it. There was just something about this crystal, which I'd seen around, but I'd not connected with before. I'd seen them and thought, well, they're nice and pretty, but I didn't get it. I don't get the connection that some people would hold them and go, and I didn't have that. I didn't have that experience until I had this crystal, which is a really nice smoky point. And I started meditating around about that time. And that was when my inner world made sense. It was meditation was probably the doorway that suddenly I thought, this is the sort of the cosmic unlimited potential of my inner world. Suddenly, oh, this is what I've been waiting for. So that was when I sort of felt that I sort of landed on my feet and really discovered. And it was that particular crystals, and that was it. And you know what it's like, you get that first one, and then that's it. It just, all their friends come along, and you're addicted. You know how it works. And so for crystals, for me, were the beginning time. I was working with a few workbooks, and there were books by Ra Bonowitz and so forth, and they explored the sort of Atlantean crystal connection, and that was very much in vogue at that particular time. And what I was experiencing as a child, and these energies were all starting to make sense, and I was feeling this is it, this is, you know, what I'm looking for. And so I was around, that's probably about 2021 all this happened. And around about that time was very, very early computers, and extremely early computers. And I was working for a company, and had this really clumsy, in hindsight now, early computer. And I discovered this process where I would tap in questions to the computer as though that was consciousness. That was quite ordinary now, but at the time I was quite cutting edge. I didn't know anyone else who did that. And I would do that, and I was like, why am I here? That's how I started. And, you know, as you do. And I started getting replies. And in hindsight now, I can see that, you know, that's is an interesting technique to do. But nobody showed me. It just sort of happened. And I got quite into that. And then one day, I got this reply. And of course, it was coming back through my hands. But it was because I was using another object. It was somehow my consciousness was able to tell me things that I maybe not wouldn't have accepted without the computer. So I got this really clear reply, and this was 1989, and I got this really clear reply: give up your work on the 1st of September 1989. I think this was 6 weeks before then. Gave me this date and said, give up work and take a leap, and a doorway will open for you, which certain things will happen if you take that leap of faith, and it's fine if you don't. I mean, I'm sort of summarising what I didn't say exactly like this, but it was along those lines. And if you don't take that leap of faith, it's not the end of the world. But those things that are going to happen can only happen if you take this leap of faith. Then, and I mean, of course, what can you do? Of course, you have to do that. Well, I had to do that, and I knew that I was like 21, coming up to 22, and I knew. And I was living in my mother's attic, and I knew I had nothing to lose. I didn't have a car, didn't have a mortgage, I didn't have, you know, anything to lose. And I thought, somehow, if I don't do this, and if I wait, because I thought, well, you know, I could wait, I could do this at a later time. But there was a great sense of excitement. There was terror and excitement went sort of hand in hand with the whole thing. And everyone around me, if I spoke to my boss about it, and I sort of tried to do this, like, well, you know, if I give everything up, you know, can I come back later? You know, you know, you know the way you negotiate these things. And these were really important lessons to learn at an early age as well. But, you know, consciousness, you can't really negotiate if you're going to take a leap of faith. But I want to back up. You know, it's like all or nothing. So, and everyone around me was like, you know, you're mad. You know, you've got to, because I didn't do very well at school, so I had no qualifications as such. So, and everyone was like, oh, you know, if you've got this really good job and if you give it up, you know, no one's going to employ, you know, all the usual negative things around me. And nobody supported me in the process, not one single person. And all the people I was involved with, the Green Party and everything, nobody supported it. And it was really like, I've got to do this. And, you know, people like, you know, this voice, a computer's told you to do this. You know, and in hindsight, it is, you know, strange to do that. But anyway, I did it. And I walked away and left everything and went into my mother's attic and I thought, great, I've done it. I woke up the next day and I was like, right, where is it? What's going to happen now? And nothing, it went really quiet. My computer, which I'd left, of course, in the car, I didn't have my own. I was like, oh, what? God. And like, everything was like stripped away. And I sat there. So I went and meditated, quiet. I like wrote things down quiet. So I was like, God, what about this? Like, I felt really fooled and also, gosh, this is a real test. What am I going to do? And then the next day, I was like, okay, maybe this could take a couple of days. And then after about a week, and then after a month. So 3 months later, I at that point, I had, because I'd given it, I was living on £11 a week social security. Because I'd left work, that's in those days all you're given. And I was fortunate that my mother supported me in terms of I didn't have to pay any rent, and I was sort of back home, and all those things. But I was a vegan at the time, and as most vegans know, you can live really cheaply as a vegan. I just bought a bag of lentils each week and a bag of brown rice, and that's all I lived on. So my £11, I managed it. And in one sense, I'm quite a shy person. I'm not a naturally person who takes well to situations like this, for example. You know, it's quite a challenge for me to do it. And so it quite appealed to me. After a while, I thought, well, perhaps that's it. Maybe I'm just meant to sit in my mum's attic for the rest of my life and annoy my mum. And, you know, and perhaps I'm meant to be jobless and, you know, and maybe that's it. And that sort of appealed, that the shyer side of my nature, that quite appealed to me. And I thought, actually, yeah, and I started getting into it. And of course, now I can see what's happening. Of course, that I was relaxing that initial tension of like, where is it? You know, what am I meant to do? And I started obviously to accept the situation. And I had a lot of time, obviously, to play with my crystals at that time. Once I sort of got into it, I was like, actually, I've got all day, rather than, you know, rushing home from work and having 10 minutes or, you know, once in a while playing with them, I've got all day. So I, you know, I had early, and I've got a picture somewhere of an early mandala I made, just because it seemed nice to make a circle of crystals in my bedroom. And so, you know, I was experimenting and I was meditating, and you know, I was still curious as to what was happening. And I, after about 4 months of this very, very quiet universe, and in hindsight now, I've had this a few times in my life where I have leaps of faith or a lot of external activity, and then I have a quieter internal time, like a gestation period. And at that time, I had nobody to tell me things like that, so it was quite scary at times, because nobody would say to me, you know, you're in a gestation period, it's all right, enjoy it. That's part of the process. It's not always external and active. Sometimes there's very long periods of gestation and quiet and waiting. And actually, that can often be the most challenging time, because on the surface, nothing's happening, but everything is being prepared, like scaffolding internally. Anyway, I was in the gestation period without knowing that I had a name, and it was a very important stage to be in as well. So unbeknown to me, all under the surface, everything was obviously being planned and plotted for my future. And at the time, a friend of mine, Elsie, had a little healing place called Rainbows in Bishopswaltham. And it was a very, very small, special place at the time. There was nothing else like it. And Elsie was a really special being. And part of, because I have nothing to do, I volunteered to do some bits for her. And she was painting a ceiling blue with stars, as you do in this scene. And I said, oh, I'll do the stars. And so she was doing the blue bit, the ceiling, for the little healing room. And I was holding the ladder. And Elsie is one of those beings who would be very, you know, very powerful being who would be very quiet about her power. And I was aware that she was sort of tuning into something, and she was sort of doing this, and she was going, what are you going to do then? And I said, I've got no idea. And I said, it's been 4 months. And she knew my journey I'd been on. And I said, nothing's happened. And she said, crystals, I see crystals. And I said, well, I've got a few, but I didn't know anything about them. And she said, no, there's definitely something with you and crystals. And have you got any money? And I said, well, actually, I have. When I left work, I'd saved exactly £500. And she said, you've got this money? I said, yeah, I've got £500. And I said, I think, worst case scenario, I'm going to use it, I'm going to go to India. That's what it was like. India or nothing. That seemed to be the choice I had. And that's it. Well, everyone did in those days. You went to India. So I was like, yeah, I'm going to, that would get me somewhere around India. And then, I don't know. And she said, no, I think you should buy some crystals and sell some crystals. And I was like, okay. And I really trusted her. If Elsie said something, it was one of the people, when she said something, it was worth really listening to. So, and she said, look, I'll give you a phone number of a wholesaler who doesn't exist anymore. So I did. I sort of got this £500 out of the bank. I went to them. And it was this thing where I hadn't thought of it myself before, but as soon as it happened, there was this synergy. I was aware that something really powerful was about to happen. And I spent that £500, up to I think about a penny change or something like that. And I thought, God, you know, I've like lost everything now. You know, I bought like a load of rocks, and I don't know anyone who wants to buy them. I've got nothing now, absolutely nothing. I can't even go to India now. And there was no EasyJet in those days, so India was expensive. I couldn't go for a few pounds or one-way ticket. So anyway, a friend of mine said, you know, it's a little psychic fair, bring a table. And so I bought, and actually even in those days, £500 didn't go very far. So I had this little table, and I've got a photograph of it at home. It's sort of like a Polaroid thing, and the table was about that big, and if I look at what I've got now, you know, there's a few stones on there. And I remember this one geode I had, which I thought was enormous at the time. It was about that big. And that was the biggest piece I had, and I was really proud of that. And before the show opened, a lot of the readers and other table people were around. And they just cleared the table. Like, nearly everything went. And that's when I knew something was happening, something really important happening. And Bouquet said to me, you know, these are really... this is different. And I'm not saying I'm, you know, better than anyone else, but it was just different. And of course, the way I was choosing them was different. I was choosing them because of their sound emanation or the being that goes with them. Because for me, with a crystal, it's the consciousness, or someone might call them a diva, the being, the spirit, if you like, of that crystal. Which is, when we're drawn to a particular crystal, it's that we're drawn to. That is what we're going to have the relationship with. Or if you're using a piece for clients, that being is what you're going to have the relationship with as a client or as a healer as well. And so anyway, things took off from there, and then I started Risti. And it was a few years in, I kept thinking, oh, I'm still waiting for it to happen, whatever it is I'm here to do. And it was one day I was going into the shop and I looked up and I saw, you know, Christia. And it was this, and I think that would have been about 2 years after this, where I kept thinking, well, I'll do this, I'll sell crystals, while I work out what I'm doing, what I'm going to be doing. And it did take about 2 years before it dawned on me. And I walked under the sign one day and looked up, and it was a sudden revelation of, oh, I'm doing it. And it suddenly all caught up with me that I was really in the right place at the right time and I was doing the right thing. And that's when everything sort of came into sort of focus and clarity. And everything happened, and that's been quite a few years, about 25 years now. And a few years ago, so I'll just keep an eye on time. A few years ago, as everyone does in this field, after about sort of 15 years of being involved in crystals, it comes to most people, I'm going to write a book. You know, it happens. We all go through that process. And put something down and put it into print. And I know a lot of people in the crystal healing business, a lot of writers, a lot of sort of healers and teachers and lots of people. So I got to the phase of, I'm going to write, to put something down. And every time I started, it felt like I was going to be writing like other people. It's like, well, that's what Sue and Simon say about that stone, or that's what Judy says about that stone, so I'll carry on that information. And I felt that I wanted to write something sort of from my experience and from my being. And to gather the energies of my lifetime experience into my work, rather than taking it for granted what other people said about stones. So I began to sort of meditate with them and ask them what it is they wanted to impart about a particular stone. And the first stone I started with was Aguite, or Aquite, which is the Spanish pronunciation. And I had this, I sat in front of my computer and I had a piece of Aguite in my lap. And I was like, okay, come on, tell me your story. And you know, as most of you know, sort of when you ask questions, it depends on the particular time and place, but you know, if you ask certain questions, sometimes big experiences come in. So I was sat with this Aguite in my lap, and the next thing I knew, I was rising out of my body and moving at the speed of light, or the speed of inner light. And I was really aware that I was moving out of my body and actually eventually looking down on the planet. And there was this odd feeling at the same time. I thought, am I going? Because I didn't know what was going to happen, but I thought, I'm going. This isn't quite how I imagined going, and I'm not quite ready. I've only just started, and I'm going. And there was a part of me that sort of was all right with that at the same time, and at the same time, not all right with it. because I was like, oh God, I've only just learned to be all right on this planet, and now I'm off. And you know, it had been a challenge for me to be incarnate, to be in a body, and to enjoy the earth plane. And there was this funny, odd feeling of like, oh damn it, you know, I've just sort of mastered this, and I'm off, and I don't want to. I've just learned to enjoy it. But anyway, off I went out into the cosmos. And I was very aware, I was right out in the universe. And I'm sure many of you know, when you go out in the universe, it's a very expansive, quiet space where one can hear even planets moving and star systems moving. It's a very, when you have those experiences, they're utterly humbling. And our sense of how small we are in the universe is just overwhelming. So I find myself out in the edge of the universe thinking I've died, or am I having an out-of-body experience? I'm not quite sure what's going on. And slowly coming towards me was this enormous turquoise light in the shape of a mandala. And this mandala was coming towards me, and I felt utterly safe. I didn't feel threatened by it in any way, shape or form. I was aware that this light and sound was coming towards me. And I mean, what you do in those situations, of course, you go into it. I mean, it was like this, I couldn't resist. And I just found myself going into this light. And the only thing I can describe is a sense of dissolving and a sense of disappearing. How long I was there, I don't know. It was an interesting day because there was nobody in the house and there was nobody in the office apart from me. So I had no way of timing how long all this took. So it could have been a few seconds, it could have been a few hours, I really don't know. And I was dissolved in this light, and the next moment or the next hour, I'm not quite sure in our time, I found myself out, sort of a bit like being pushed out of this light and slowly coming back down to Earth into my body, finding myself back in front of the computer, holding the statuette, going, okay, I asked, and that's what I got. and I didn't write about that. I have no idea that the Oversoul cards or what I wrote about them would that was what was happening. I had no idea. I just thought that was a one-off experience. And I went upstairs because I felt like I'd been electrocuted. I felt like I'd stuck my fingers in a plug, you know, with a cheap hairdryer, and I, you know, I'd got an electric shock, but on a cosmic scale. And I went and laid in the bath, and all I can remember is laying in the bath and thinking the only place I could be is in water. And I remember just having my head out of the water and just laying there for about an hour in the water, trying to make sense of what I'd experienced, but also, my body wasn't shaking, but it felt like my whole body, my whole system was shaking. In hindsight, of course, what I was doing was absorbing the energy. What I was doing, my cells, my DNA, my whole energy field was processing that energy. And water seemed to be the natural place. In hindsight, I would have thought it had been earth, but it was water. Warm water seemed to do me really well. And so I lay there, and I was thinking a lot about what I'd seen, and I recalled as much as possible I could see. And suddenly I heard the Ajuite sort of voice say to me, you know, now you must write my story. And so I dried myself and wrote down what I'd experienced, or tried to encapsulate what I'd experienced. And it dawned on me as I was doing that wasn't going to be a one-off experience, that I suddenly became aware that there were others like waiting in the wings. And me and Ruth, when we were driving here, so we were talking about sort of fairies and elementals and beings. And it's interesting when you sort of get in contact with different inner forces, or forces which exist beyond the normal planes of consciousness, when they find a vehicle to speak through, like all their friends come along because they're, oh great, you know, we've got something to speak. So we were talking about sort of fairies and beings and dragons and earth elementals yesterday, and like, you know, when it's like all their friends gather and go, great, you know, but it's like, you can talk on our behalf. So that's what it felt like at the time, that there were all these other oversouls waiting to speak. So that was my work over the next few months to write down. And the cards are the best I could do to encapsulate their energy. And what they essentially told me, because one of the questions I had when I was working the cards were, why, you know, why do you want to, what's this about? You know, what do you, I've got a Taurus moon, so I need to sort of make things quite practical for me to understand them. And the way I understood it was the oversoul consciousness, they were, so there exists as these sort of temples of light. And in both sets of my cards now, there's 66 which I've explored. So each one I would have this encounter where I would meditate with them and they would impart their story. And what I understood through their temples is that they were once here on this plane, those temples. They've had to recede. They are on the inner planes now. But they were once physical temples on this plane. So, for example, rose quartz, for example. When we, there was a physical rose quartz temple, and as different beings, when we approach these temples, all these consciousness, and I'm not saying you need my card for this to happen at all. These energies are for everyone, and for all I've done is in my own limited way, is to put them in a certain perspective and a certain form. But you don't need my cards, and you don't need the crystals either. They're, you know, those consciousness are there for everyone. But if you do work with my cards and the meditations of them, the way I understand them is each one is like an attunement, is an initiation. So for example, we're working with rose quartz. When we're working with the stone, we are connecting to the temple. We're connecting to its mother energy. So, and that's whether we've got the physical stone or we can just tune into that energy as well. But I look at it, say, with all of, you know, rose quartz, when we've got a piece of rose quartz in our hand, that consciousness of that particular rose quartz has its overriding mother energy. And so we're actually, when we're holding that, we can if we like, don't have to of course, but we can if we're like, we're connecting to its source, its feeding source. It's the overlighting diva, or the overlighting angel, if you like, that looks after all of rose quartz. Or say, for example, smoky quartz. So when we work with smoky quartz, we're connecting with the overlighting energy of all smoky quartz. So, of course, our relationship, if we want to, our relationship with crystals, we can sort of take it to another level. So where the crystals themselves, when we have that sort of approach or that consciousness, the crystals themselves can reconnect. Sometimes they're already connected. Sometimes they're not. Sometimes they become disconnected from their mother source. And sometimes as healers, of course we know that, we might get a crystal in it, they might feel off, they might feel they've picked up something. They themselves have been, I mean, you know, with all crystals, they're always picking up and emitting energy. And sometimes in misguided hands, a crystal can become sort of off. I imagine them, say for example, if I had a rose quartz in my hand here and the rose quartz mandala sort of imagined over there, it's a bit like these strands of light which connect the crystal to its other energy. And so when we're working with a piece, sometimes that strand is absolutely complete and intact, and it's a bit like the crystal's umbilical cord. And sometimes, as in human beings and all consciousness, sometimes that core, that light, that connection can become a bit distorted. So when we have that consciousness that there is a larger sort of force field of light that looks after each of its crystals and looks after us, then our relationship with crystals, I think, has a possibility of changing and becoming even more enhanced. We're able to open our consciousness and our field and our understanding of crystals on a much sort of wider scale, and therefore our perception of the universe itself changes, because once we have a relationship like that with crystals, of course, if we like, we can look at trees, hills, mountains, forests, people, food. Everything has conscious. Everything has an overlighting, larger force field of energy, which is, if we want to, we can expand our knowledge and our awareness and our connection and our sense of the interconnectivity of all these fields of consciousness. Because, of course, they themselves are looked after and guided by other fields of consciousness. And we can just expand our consciousness on and on and on out into the cosmos and remain grounded all at the same time. And that's my feeling of where we are at the moment, is our ancient consciousness has become, up to 20 years, up to 2012, and now beyond, a lot of beings, ancient beings, are here again, are incarnate again. And that's why I feel confidence that this is so important, because there's a sense of connection, there's a sense of belonging, that all us crystal outsiders actually are really important, and it's really important that we get together and expand our light and connect and reconnect with people. Because we're here on purpose, and we're here to make some change, to stimulate change, and we can do that in very small ways as well. We're not, you know, we don't all have to be Mother Teresa, where, you know, we can do things on our own small scale as well, but they're all adding up, they're all connecting. And when we are, what I feel at the moment, what's happening is our, the light that nourishes us, that cares for us, is becoming more readily available and is expanding and sort of pushing us out, pushing us to, rather than be hermits and be quiet, go, you know, I'll stay at home with my crystals. Or me, as when I was 20 years old, I'll stay in my mum's attic and nobody will notice I'm here, and all that sort of stuff. My being obviously wanted something different. And gave me the support system in order to be able to do that very slowly. You know, it didn't sort of suddenly shove me onto a world stage or something. It just very slowly supported me and supported that light and that knowledge. And so my work with the Crystal Oversouls is about, for those who are drawn to it, is about working with the meditations for them, working with the mandalas on the cards. And also, I'm doing a workshop this afternoon and tomorrow morning. And my work is often we build mandalas on the floor with the cards. For example, one we're doing this afternoon, I build a symbol of the old earth and the new earth. And where we are at the moment is this, we're in this interesting transition at the moment from the old earth energy to the new earth energies. And so a lot of my work is very experiential and very, rather than telling you what an oversoul does or whatever, I like people to experience these things for themselves in their bodies. And to allow those energies, encourage it through sound as well, to allow those energies to sort of unfold in the moment and allow our light to share itself amongst each other. And the my work with Oversoul is sort of continuous in terms of they, I've probably, never say never, because I don't know, but I probably feel that the work with where I've taken them for the moment is probably it. There's 66 now, but never say never, I might return to them, but I'm sort of working on something else at the moment, which is a slight variation on the subject, but actually the actual mandalas themselves are probably, and they've indicated as well, that they're not just random mandalas. Each of them is here on purpose. And each of them is here to attune and to support our process. So the cards in the green deck, the one that came out last year, all those cards are designed to support our transition into the new earth, for example. So the meditations and the mandalas for those are designed to help us if we're if we get stuck. And that's a very interesting process when we get stuck. And the stuckness is when we, I mean, I'm sure we've all had it recently with the whole Brexit thing. That was a classic, a gigantic stuckness in the sense of, you know, we're making this transition onto the new earth. And then we have things come along that really challenge us and really challenge our relationship with humanity. And our stuckness is when we sort of, things don't make sense and we sort of slip back onto the old earth and slip back into old habits and patterns. And the new earth is taking, some of the things that we've had on the old earth are going to be the same, so, but just taken to another octave. And part of the work I've been doing in a group that I've been working with Ruth and a few people has been working with how do we navigate onto the new earth gracefully. Sometimes we do ungracefully as well, that's part of the process, but how do we navigate that and therefore help other people make that transition easier. I don't have all the answers to that, I don't pretend I do. I'm not sure myself of the whole science behind it in terms of how the new earth is going to be, how humanity is going to manage this, but I am experiencing it. I'm experiencing, for me, the new earth energy is when that energy where everything happens actually without us even thinking, we're thinking it. Without it's a sense of ease and a sense of, I wasn't, you know, that's really fast. I'm thinking that, or I hadn't even dared to think that, and it's happening already. That is, I'm having experiences like that, where in the old days, on the old earth, you have to do sort of inner processes, or do affirmations, or do some sort of process to make something happen. And the new earth is a bit like the new earth listens to something even before we know we want it and makes it happen. And that sense of ease and that sense of grace is beautiful, but of course it can be quite unsettling as well. We have moments where it's all going like wonderfully like that, and then suddenly we hit a slight resistance in ourselves even to that ease as well. And then our work, of course, is to work through that resistance. So the new cards, the new deck, was designed to help in that process, to help. I remember when I did it, there were obsidian and black tourmaline came forward, and first of all I was like, oh no, I can't write about you, you're black. No, everyone liked pretty pinks and purples and lilacs, and I put them to one side. I was like, no, I'm not talking about you, you can wait. Anyway, they were like really adamant. And so anyway, I did, and they're in form now. But once I went through the meditation with them and wrote about them, I realized just how powerful they are and how important it is to, and that for me is probably one of the essential things about crystals, how, of course, the nice purples and pinks, and they're the easy ones, and they're, the ones that most of us can just take quite naturally to, but it's the ones where we go, oh, I don't like that, that's a dark colour or whatever. They're the ones who often have the most gold within them. And I don't mean the gold colour, but they're the alchemical process where we, when we encounter that resistance, when we go, why don't I like that? What is it about that I don't like? And when we embrace that, when we move into that, that's what those two stones taught me about the most, that actually the meditations for them are really powerful, because there's no challenge in those stones. All they're asking us to do is to face certain things and face how we do certain things and face our attitude how we do things. And actually, they're two of my favourite stones now, because I loved writing about them in the end. But I remember at the first time I was thinking, oh, I can't, because, you know, people have a certain image of, you know, the nice cards and the nice crystals and antennas. And so they were a challenge for me to make them public. And I sort of, in the beginning, I thought I'd be criticised for doing them. And I wasn't, and never have. And actually, on the contrary, people have approached me and said, I'm really glad you put those in, because, you know, they're really important that we have these more challenging crystals and initiations with crystals as well, because that is where we learn the most. And of course we learn through the nice pinks and purples and things, but actually the more challenging stones have a great wealth of energy within them that when we sort of embrace them, releases that energy, and actually we're bigger because of it. Any questions about that process or... yeah, we finished about 5 minutes. So if there's any questions, sometimes questions are really interesting. Yes, Crystal.
I'd like to ask you, you spoke about sometimes crystals are not actually always connected.
Yeah.
Can you reconnect them?
Yes, I think that's part of the our relationship with crystals as well. And all you need to do is, with that crystal, is connect it, and just imagine its cord and its sort of line of light to its mother, if you like, to its mother consciousness. And just reimagining that, in my opinion, work, that's the connection. And the crystal will be forever grateful to you. Never leave your side after that. So, and I think that's part of our consciousness work, that we're able to support minerals and crystals in that way as well. And once they've made that connection, they're often often running. Yeah? Okay, good. Yeah?
Has your relationship with your blind parents changed as you've grown involved? Are they still around?
Yeah, they're still around, yeah. I sort of channel them through my, through this, through my work, and but yeah, they're still hovering around doing their stuff. And when, if I'm, I must say, gestation periods are still a challenge for me. So they're particularly helpful in gestation periods where I go, oh, it's gone very quiet. I'm in one at the moment. So I had a 5-year run where I did 4 books in a row, and it was like all this energy poured out of me and all this creativity, and then obviously working with publishers, doing lots of PR and interviews and stuff like that. And then one book felt like, as soon as I finished the draft and sent to my publisher, the next one would come through, and I was like, wow, I'm really on a roll here. And then it went really quiet. And that gestation period is always a challenge for me. And I'm learning to enjoy it, and that's when they come into their own. And I'm always nagging them, going, and they're going, it's all right. And they sort of know what I'm going to ask them before I ask it. And they go, it's all right. Probably don't do that, but you know what I mean. It's like, it's all part of, you know, there's a process, a journey taking place, and that is where they come into their strength for me anyway, because they remind me that. To rest and enjoy that phase, and to just sort of grow and allow, and to nurture, as a mother does with a child. That's what it feels like with a book. It feels, for me, when I'm working on something, it feels like I'm nurturing a divine child. And then when it's put into form, anyone who tells you who's written a book, that is a nerve-wracking stage, because it feels like your child is going to college, you know, or going out, you know, going to school for the first time. It's really quite a frightening process, especially the first book. And so that's where they work strongest with me. And that hasn't changed my relationship with, it didn't change my relationship with my parents. I still had a very good relationship with my parents. They were just like from the stars rather than from the earth. And that's sort of how I viewed them. So I still asked my parents things, and that didn't have any reflection on them at all. And But the only thing it did have was when I was very young, I went for a period where I thought I was adopted because I felt so different in my family, and especially having, you know, light around me and beings telling me this and telling me that, I really thought I'd like somehow come from the stars and like been put in my family. I mean, it really had that, because that can play tricks, you know, as a child. If you have that experience, then it's really like, you know, it's great for fantasy, but, you know, and imagination. But actually, you know, it could play havoc with, like, actually, where have I come from? So my mother was mortified when I said, have I been adopted? And she was like, of course you have it. And she was like, where'd you get this idea from? But I was convinced for a couple of years I'd come from somewhere else. And I'm still, that's still fine. Now I've grown into that I have, but I wasn't adopted. You know what I mean? It was, I've got a better relationship that now as an adult, but as a child, went for a long time. And it didn't help that my parents had lots of pictures of my brothers and sisters and hardly any of me. And that really played havoc at that time, because when I found them, I was like, I mean, all my mother said, we didn't have any money at that time, so we didn't have a camera and we didn't take many pictures. And when your sister was born, you know, we had more money, we had a camera. It's as simple as that, really. But yeah, that was crazy, because I was absolutely convinced. Yeah, so it's a good thing, but for children, it's, you know, it can be a challenge as well. And of course, there's lots of sort of crystal children, indigo children around, or adults now, some of them, who have of course gone through that same process as well. But I wouldn't say I was necessarily an indigo child or crystal child. I was just, I don't know what it was. I don't know the name for it, but, in one sense, they've got more support, those children, because their parents are more conscious of that than mine were. But, you know, they're still great people.
Pushed off the stage.
Thank you.
No, I'm not pushing you off. I'm saying thank you so much.
Thank you.